When you look at the depth of the wisdom that Christ has, and you start to study his sayings, there would be a lot of sayings that are difficult for us to really get a handle on. And the one that I selected is found in the Gospel of John, chapter 14 and verse 12. So if you'd take your Bibles, and you need your Bibles this morning to follow along in this passage as we look at it, John chapter 14 and verse 12. It's a very simple verse. And you know, when you study the Gospel of John or study the other Gospel writers, it always amazes me, because when you ever study Greek, when you're studying the New Testament, they always move you to the Gospel of John or the writings of John, because his Greek is so, it's simple. The words, the vocabulary is simple. I sort of identify with that, because I look at my English and I think, you know, my vocabulary is not that broad. I use the same words over and over again. I sort of have a heart like John, and that's what you find here. He has a very simplistic type of vocabulary, and yet when you study his words, they are very deep and thought-provoking. And as he recorded something that Jesus said in John chapter 14, and I'm going to just read verse 12, and then we'll have a word of prayer as we begin. But here's the words. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these will he do, because I go to my Father. I would entitle the message, Doing Greater Works Than Jesus. And you might say, what? That almost sounds like blasphemy to say such a thing. But that's really not my title, is it? We just read the very words of Jesus. It really comes out of his saying. And so I would like to spend a little time on this verse and pray that God would enlighten us, help us to understand, and try to sense what Jesus was trying to say in this very difficult phrase. So let's just pray as we begin. Father, I thank you so much for everyone that is here this morning and those that might be watching as well, that you might take the words that are spoken, that they might honor you, and they might help us to understand what your plan is for us and why such a statement was ever made. So, Father, guide our thoughts here this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, when I first look at that statement, it to me, it comes from the words of our Lord. It almost sounds ridiculous to me on the surface when I first read it. And there are several reasons I would say that, and I think you would agree if you look at the very last verses of the Gospel of John. So I'm going to have you paging different places in John so that you better understand his writings on this. In verses 24 and 25 of John chapter 21, it says, This is the disciple who testifies of these things and wrote these things, and we know that his testimony is true. And there are also many other things that Jesus did which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. That's about the life of Christ. And that's the way I reflect as I think of the life of Christ. As you look at this, you think, yeah, that's really true. If they recorded everything that Jesus did, it would be amazing. John only recorded 7 miracles. And yet there were so many more that were never recorded. When you think of the people of Israel and their response, it was written in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 9. It has never been seen in this fashion before, speaking of the miracles of Christ. When Jesus spoke, it said in the Gospel of John, we didn't arrest him because no man ever, ever spoke like this man. The whole life of Christ, as you read the Gospels, is so amazing when you read it, that for Jesus to make a statement like this is just hard to understand where he's headed with such a statement. It is such a powerful statement. So what I'd like to do is try to break down a little bit on what Jesus was saying as we come to this passage. Now, going back to John chapter 14, to the very passage that we are interested in, and we'll try to unpack a little bit as we go through, I want to just note a few things here that Jesus tries to say right up in front as you look at the verse itself, and then we're going to go back a little bit into the context. In the New King James Version, it says, "Most assuredly I say to you." Now, if you were to study that in the Greek, it would simply have two words that start this statement. Amen, amen. That's what it says in the Greek. In fact, when you look at this phrase, amen, amen, it's very unique how Jesus deals with it, because we normally use amen at the end of a statement to say, I believe, I agree. And yet when Jesus would use the word, oftentimes he would use it at the very beginning of a statement. And in the Gospel of John, there's 25 occasions in which Jesus not only says amen once, he says amen, amen. And the whole idea is, please pay attention to what I am about to say to you. It is crucial and it is important. So when you start this verse, you understand Jesus is trying to draw our attention. He doesn't want you to pass over this verse like when you read the gospel so often, you read through things and then you really didn't pay attention, you really didn't pick up. He doesn't want you to do that with this verse. There's a lot of other verses in John that Jesus uses this same phraseology. Amen, I say unto you, unless a man is born again, he will never enter the kingdom of heaven. An important statement by Jesus? Clearly it was. And then he goes back in that passage in John and he says, amen, amen, I say unto you, unless a man is born of the Spirit and the water, he will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Do you think Jesus was serious when he made those statements? Do you think anybody is going to enter the kingdom of God without experiencing the new birth? Impossible. And so I would say, even as we begin this message, if you're here and listen to messages or you're not sure that the new birth has ever taken place in your life, I just want to share one truth that Jesus would share. Without the new birth, you'll never enter the kingdom of heaven. It's impossible. So make certain that that is true in your life. Not only was Jesus trying to cause us to really pay attention as he shared, because I really don't think the disciples picked up on what he was saying here. And as we go through part of the context, you'll pick that up, because Jesus is telling them that he's going to leave. They want to follow him. Why can't they follow him? All of that is taking place in here. So I don't know if they really listened to what he was saying in this verse, but we clearly have the advantage of going back and studying and listening clearly as he goes through. Now, there's something else that tells me that this is such an important passage, and probably one of the favorite sections of the Bible is John chapter 14 through 16. It's such just a precious, precious portion of Scripture. But Jesus uses emphatic pronouns throughout this section of Scripture. Now you say, what is an emphatic pronoun? I often use a simplistic example here. I use Spanish because I do use Spanish at times and enjoy doing that. And I often say, if you have to say, I speak, how many words do you need in Spanish? And anybody that's familiar with the Spanish language, you only need one word, hablo. That's it. You don't need to say, I speak, because the pronoun is contained in the verb. That's the way a number of languages work. But if you do use the pronoun, that makes it emphatic. That's saying, I want to emphasize my place in this statement. Now, here's the interesting part. I know everybody has sometimes phones is where they pick up their Bible version. I've never got used to that. I still use the old book. But as you go through, there's things that I would always circle in my Bible. And as I started to study Greek, every time I come to an emphatic pronoun, I always circle it because it helps me understand how important these phrases are. Now, let me just sort of tip off a little bit of what Jesus is doing, because there's emphatic pronouns that are used. And if you read, you know, the normal Greek text, they're not all that often. But here, they are used very often. Let me just point out as you go through this text in John chapter 14. John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus said, I am the way. I am is just one Greek word, but if you use the pronoun, it can be two. It's very emphatic. And Jesus is saying in John 14, 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Very emphatic. In John chapter 14 and verse 10, notice what it says here. Do you not believe that I am in the Father? That I is emphatic. And it goes on to word, and it says, and the Father's in me. The words that I speak, that's emphatic as well. When you go to John chapter 14 and verse 11, believe me that I am, again, emphatic pronoun as you go to 14:11. 14:12, most assuredly, the verse that we just read at the very end, because I go to my Father, that's emphatic. When you go to John 14, verse 14, if you ask anything in my name, I, again, that's emphatic, I will do it. John chapter 14, verse 16. He goes on to say, and I will ask the Father. There are emphatic pronouns all throughout this passage, which really helps you to sense that Jesus is passionately teaching this section of Scripture, trying to grab their attention, helping them to know that he himself is very involved in this text. Those things give a hint of the importance of this text. Now, there's three great things here that I've tried to note as I've gone through this passage. The first one, actually, to me, I just call the great contrast. The great contrast as I look at this passage of Scripture. If you back up in John chapter, because we just read verse 14, but if you back up to John chapter 13, which is naturally in the very same setting, look at verse 36 with me. This is Simon Peter as Jesus is talking about him, you know, where are you going? And then Jesus says, Simon Peter said to him, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered, where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you shall follow me afterward. You shall follow me afterward. Peter said to him, Lord, why cannot I follow you now? I will lay down my life for your sake. Jesus answered, will you lay down your life for my sake? Most assuredly, I say to you, the rooster shall not crow till you have denied me three times. I don't have time to enlarge on all the gospel accounts that even speak more about Peter's statements and how he said, you know, some of these may deny you, Lord, but I'll never deny you. Here you have Peter, very dedicated, very confident in self that he can follow the Lord, and yet we know, even in Jesus' words, this man is headed for failure. He's going to fall, and Jesus said he's going to fall. Here's Peter. Now, here's the whole idea. Here you have disciples. Not only is Peter going to fall, all of them are going to forsake the Lord in his time of need. Every single one of them is going to take off and leave the Lord by himself when they're threatened. Great group of men, you know, to grab courage and to surround, they took off. So how is it to this very same group of men, which Jesus knew they were going to forsake him, then you also have on the other side, verse 12, he says to them, amen, amen, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these will he do. And you might, well, how in the world does that go together? Here's men that are going to forsake him, and now at the same setting, Jesus is saying to the same group of men that they're going to do greater works. To me, it's mind-boggling to me. What a great contrast between these men that are going to forsake him, and now Jesus' whole goal as he looks and he speaks to these men. It's just interesting to me as you go through this section of Scripture. Now, with the great contrast, as you look at the great contrast, there's something else here that we need to sort of, I guess, digest or understand within the text itself, that I think there's a great principle here that Jesus is endeavoring to help them understand. Now, notice as you follow along in John chapter 14, I'm going to pick it up in verse 7. This is what it says here. If you had known me, Jesus said, let me just go back up to verse 6. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes unto the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Now, great question, I suppose, with that, but you know, when you think it through a little bit more, we know that the Father is spirit. Jesus said that in John chapter 4. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. So when Philip says, show us the Father, What do you mean by that, Philip? I mean, nobody can see the Father. So how in the world do you say, show us the Father? I mean, when you think through the question, you start to see that the understanding of these men, it's very much like us. We're longing for something we can put our hands on, and yet clearly that was going to be impossible. But Jesus comes back to him to answer that question. Jesus said to him, verse 9, have I been with you so long and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me, I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Very simple, interesting words, but also very mind-boggling. But to me, not only do you have the great contrast in what Jesus said about Peter and the other disciples, and then for them to do greater works, now you have the great principle of indwelling deity as you look at this statement. Now notice on several places here, notice he says in verse 10, the Father is in me. He says that in verse 10. And then he comes back to it so you don't miss it. The Father is in me. That's what Jesus is saying. And so as you look at Christ, the whole idea, in fact, he says the Father is doing the works, which is a very interesting statement. I mean, he sort of reflects and makes some of these statements in other passages of Scripture. Notice in John chapter 5, verse 17, but Jesus answered them, my Father has been working until now, and I am working, but again, giving reference to the Father himself. But notice the other one. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. As Jesus reflected on his life, he gave credit to the Father for the very works that were taking place in him. And you know, if you really study the life of Christ, it is interesting because it goes beyond that. Many verses of Scripture, which we don't have time to go through, talk about the work of the Holy Spirit within the life of Christ. Notice in Matthew 12, 28, when Jesus talks about casting out demons, he says, but if I cast out demons, notice what he says, by the Spirit of God, surely the kingdom of God has come upon you. But notice in his very actions where he cast out demons, he said himself that he was doing that in the power of the Spirit of God. Another verse in Acts chapter 10, verse 38 says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him, the Spirit of God. And so as we look at the whole idea of Jesus' life, the very one thing that we need to have clear is there's indwelling deity within Christ. Now, in his incarnation, he laid aside not his personality. That's all intact. But the use of some of his powers that are really related only to deity, and it's through the power of the Father, through the power of the Son, that Jesus accomplished those great works. And that's what he's saying to these men right now. You know who the Father is because my Father is actually doing the works. And so Jesus was trying to answer the question, but he also was laying the groundwork for really the principle that he's about to state right here. So you have the great contrast, you have the great principle, the indwelling deity, and now you have the great outlook for the future. That, again, if you'd look at John chapter 14 and verse 12, the verse we're trying to take apart. Now notice what he's saying. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these will he do, because I go to my Father. Now, what was Jesus, what did he have in mind as he made that statement? At least at the end, I want to look at that because he talks about going to the Father. Now, there's several verses I think that will help us understand. If you look at John chapter 16, verse 7, notice what Jesus says here as he's giving this whole oration on the Holy Spirit and heaven and him coming back. He says this in verse 7 of chapter 16. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. Jesus had to leave in order for the Helper or the Holy Spirit to come. That's what he's saying. Now, keeping that in mind, go back to John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, and you'll start to see why Jesus is making the statement he is to his followers. Notice verse 16 of chapter 14. And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper. Now, the word another in the Greek means another of the very same kind. The first comforter is Jesus himself. The second comforter is the presence of the Holy Spirit, but he's of the same class as the first comforter. So notice what he says, I will pray the Father, and he will give you another comforter, which in all of his essence is equal to Christ himself, because they are of the same. And notice that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you, and here's a future tense, and will be in you. Coming back now to this indwelling deity, what Jesus is endeavoring to say, this same inward dwelling deity that worked so powerfully in my life is now going to become a reality in your life. That's what he's trying to say to them here. And there's such encouraging words as you try to figure out what he's trying to say, because Jesus clearly wants to emphasize, not only here in the Gospel of John, but notice, again, when we talk about the Holy Spirit, we know that from Scripture, the Holy Spirit enters every person that's a believer. Ephesians 1:13, in him you also trusted after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. He enters every single believer. Then he goes on to say in Acts 1, for John truly baptized you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Again, he implored them to stay in Jerusalem until they be endued with power from on high. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. The third great principle, then, Jesus had such a great outlook on the future because he understood this indwelling deity principle was not just there for him, but actually was going to be true in the heart of every single believer. And if we would begin to understand that, we would understand why Jesus made the statement he did in John chapter 14 and verse 12. I was reflecting on this, and I remember two messages that I heard almost 40 years ago. In some ways, that's incredible to me, because sometimes when someone preaches, or even if I preach, if a month goes by, hey, Chuck, we like that message. What did I preach on anyway? I mean, that's just the way we are. I can't even remember. The other thing is, when I say 40 years ago, I always like to group myself with the younger crowd. Always love to do that, and I can almost say, Chuck, you know, if you're talking about a message you heard 40 years ago, that sort of works against you as far as trying to come with the younger crowd. The message was given by a Dr. Taves from Canada. Never read about him afterwards, but I'll never forget his messages. And they did deal with the Holy Spirit. He said some amazing things to me that I've pondered on and I've thought about. He talked about the great power of intercessory prayer. He talked about the life of Moses and how one man delivered the nation of Israel. He talked about Abraham and how his intercession could have delivered Sodom and Gomorrah if there were 10 righteous, and how powerful. And he went on to say, he said, man prays, but it's not an activity of God. And then he said, when Jesus came as God, man, what did he spend so much time doing? And naturally it was praying. And he said, when the Holy Spirit comes, he's looking for a human body by which he can intercede to God. And actually, you know, that's exactly what Romans says. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. How? Now he searches the hearts, knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And this man said, can you imagine if we gave ourselves to the Spirit of God and prayed according to his direction? Do you have any idea how much could be accomplished just by the work of the Holy Spirit within our lives? And I pondered that, still do to this day. There's another thing, there's another verse that he talked about that I found very transforming, and I've mentioned this man before, but the Holy Spirit gives such liberty and transforms. It says, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. But he emphasized where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And he said he, being a Bible college teacher up in Canada, became convicted on sharing his faith. So he said he set up a time every day, 4 to 5 in the afternoon, after he was done studying, that he was going to go out into the community and try and share his faith, which he began to do. He said, I would go up to the doors and I'd knock on the doors. And he would say, I hope they're not home. And I could identify with that. But he said when he began to understand the presence of the Spirit of God, and he said he did that because he was so conscious of the people on the other side of the door. When he started to study about the Spirit of God, he realized that his thought pattern was wrong. That in reverse, he should be thinking about the Spirit of God that dwelt in him. And he said, when I finally got that right, he said, my whole ministry changed. I didn't fear the people on the other side of the door. I was conscious of the very Spirit of God that indwelt me. And I never forgot that example. And I use it to this day. Why is it that we fear so much when the Spirit of the living God dwells within us? There's no reason for that, is there? You know, as I think through those messages that I heard so long ago that still impact my life, they really were centered on the very thing that Jesus was trying to say, going back to John chapter 14, 12. Now, again, listen to our Lord's words as we look at this. It says, he that believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than this will he do, because I go to my Father. Now, I wrote these things down because I didn't want to mess it up to a certain degree. Jesus was not expressing his great confidence in his followers as much as he was expressing his great confidence in the Holy Spirit. You see, Jesus understood that the Spirit of God empowered him. When he looked at what was going to happen, his confidence and focus was not on the followers. It was on the work of the Spirit of God and how powerful the Spirit of God is. He knew, even though with sinful vessels, God the Holy Spirit would overcome us, would overshadow us. Praise God. He knew that would happen. And that's why he was so positive about the future. I jotted down some notes here as I go. It says, don't be so impressed with Pastor Pat and his messages. Be impressed that the Spirit of God has so overcome Pastor Pat's life that he's taken a common worker in John Beer and caused him to be someone who can preach the gospel with great power. But don't be impressed with Pat. Be impressed with the Spirit of God. That's what you have to be impressed with, because that's where Jesus' focus is here. He's never impressed with men, but he knew the power of the Spirit of God. So what does a great church look like that begins to understand this principle? Again, I wrote some things down. A great church looks like the Holy Spirit overcoming the husband so that he loves and leads his wife the way God intended. A good church looks like the Holy Spirit overpowering a wife so that she submits according to the will of God. Children are overcome by the power of the Spirit of God to obey, to honor. A coward is overcome by the Spirit of God to witness. A family that is so family-focused that it forgets God is overcome by God, and they have a biblical emphasis. And to the person who desires to show mercy or have compassion and sacrifice, the Spirit of God overcomes that person to accomplish the very will of God. You say, well, how does that happen? And because of time, we can't go there this morning, but I clearly would encourage you to read Acts chapter 4, because there you will find a small group of believers who is threatened by the Jewish authorities. They take their whole ordeal to God, and instead of asking God to give them protection, they say to God, God, grant to us boldness that we may speak your word. Because as they searched the word of God, they sensed that they should be witnesses. So they looked at what they should do, and they knew what they couldn't do, and they cried unto God. God heard their prayer. He shook the earth. And they gave great witness by the Spirit of God. And not only that, as you look at that whole thing, other people were moved to sell their houses to meet the needs of believers. How can you explain all of that? Other than the Holy Spirit overpowered believers and brought about a common good for God. So how could the works be greater than Jesus's? There's a number of ways to look at that, but here's several. First of all, the greatest miracle that takes place within a person's life is not great miracles of physical healing. That only lasts temporarily. It is the conversion of the heart. That's a great miracle. And you know, as you look at the preaching of Christ and when he brought his life to a close and he preached to those disciples, there were 500 that were gathered at once, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I'm not trying to say there were only 500 disciples, but those were the faithful ones when Jesus was done. And then you look at Acts chapter 2. In one day, 3,000 were converted to Christ. In another 5,000. And I think if you would have gone around to Jerusalem and talked to the people that were there in that day, they probably, as they looked in opposition to Christ, they probably would have said, it is worse now than when Jesus was here. Good night, they're taking over Jerusalem. Jesus knew that would happen, and that's why he said, greater works than these will they do. Not because the workers were anything, but the Spirit of God got in control of those believers' lives. Another way you could look at it, in a sense, as you look at the length of ministry, Jesus had 3 years of ministry. Almost all of tradition tells us most of the apostles had 30 years in which they did great works as the Spirit of God empowered them. But surely the numbers, it's very clear as you look at, again, John 14:12. Most assuredly, I say to you, and this is where it's so powerful to me. It doesn't say just certain believers. He says this, he who believes in me, and naturally, when you think of the Gospel of John, he who believes in me has everlasting life, because everybody who believes gains everlasting life. Isn't that true? But here he says, he that believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these. Jesus knew that what was going to be unleashed in the world was not just one Christ who was physically confined to one area like Jerusalem, like Samaria, like Galilee. He knew what was going to happen is once the Spirit of God came upon the church, let's say it right, little Christ, we're going to be dispersed throughout all the world, preaching the Word of God, doing great acts of love. And yes, we are sinful vessels, but when you look at that work, and I would even say today, across the world, how many places are there like this that are preaching the gospel of Christ? People being saved, people being witnessed to. How many people do you think are being witnessed to right now as I speak? We have no idea. But I'm certain it's thousands and millions of places the witness is going out. Why? The Spirit of God has gotten and overshadowed the lives of believers to the place where God's work goes on with great power. You see, when Jesus made that statement, there was no great confidence in men. Jesus knew personally the power of the Spirit of God in his own life, and he knew the Spirit of God would overpower and work in the lives of his followers. And that's why he made the statement. And our response, you know, as you think through the whole lesson, as we bring it to our response, how do you respond to that? We know that sin grieves the Spirit of God. To me, when I listen to the words of Christ, I would say, oh God, I want you to overpower me. I know what I'm like. And there's certainly nothing to brag about. But I have watched God step in, help me within my family. I have watched God help me to share the Word of God. I don't know of anything greater in life than let the Spirit of God overpower, overshadow you and use you to the glory of God. Is there anything greater than that, really? Is there anything else to live for? I don't know what else there is. I just get excited to be a small part. But clearly it's the work of the Spirit of God. And my question to all of us, would you allow the Spirit of God to overpower you and to use you? And that's going to come out different in every person's life and every personality, but there will be great devotion to Christ, great love for Christ, great love for others, great sacrifice for Christ, and our lives will be centered on Christ as the Spirit of God gets a hold of us. My prayer is that that work would grow greatly here in our church. Let's just bow our heads in a word of prayer.